Thank you. We are about to move into the next item of our business, so could I please make a plea to the members of the public who are leaving the gallery to please do so quickly and quietly. Thank you very much for your cooperation. So the next item of business is a members' business debate on motion 12559 in the name of Alec Rowley on physiotherapy workforce shortage in Scotland. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I would ask those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Alec Rowley to open the debate. Mr Rowley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would want to begin by thanking those members who signed my motion for this debate and my business manager for giving me the time to have the debate. In this debate, I am focusing on physiotherapy workforce shortages, but the wider issue I am raising here today is the failure of workforce planning in our NHS. And my main plea today to the government is you have got to get to grips with workforce planning, for the failure in workforce planning means we simply store up problems across the NHS, and failure in one area simply adds to pressure in other areas. I'm going to read out the content of an email I received from a constituent, as I believe this sums up the issues I'm referring to in this debate. My constituent wrote, and I quote, "As a chartered physiotherapist working for NHS Scotland and living in your constituency, I wish to raise my concerns regarding the shortage of physiotherapists in the NHS workforce. Scotland does not currently educate or train enough physiotherapists to supply workforce needs, and this is placing enormous pressure on services. It is extremely difficult to recruit physiotherapists to join my community respiratory team. We look after the most severely ill housebound population with COPD in an attempt to prevent admission to hospital. Reducing the needs for admission to hospital is obviously a key political priority, with hospitals at maximum capacity and vulnerable people lying on trolleys and corridors, sometimes for their whole admission. The shortage of physiotherapy staff impacts across our teams. Staff morale is suffering as we work with increasing levels of stress and work pressures, and we are prevented from delivering the care that we would wish to provide. We have recently had to stop the provision of services to those with less acute disease, where we would be providing education to improve long-term self-management, to reduce the long-term severity of COPD, and ultimately hospital admissions further down the line. Increasing numbers are leaving the team due to the increased workload and stress, which only exacerbates the issues. Patients also suffer from the effects of short staffing, as the service often has to close when we are at capacity for that day. Patients are then advised to contact the GP, increasing their caseloads. Patients often can't get through to the GP and end up with NH24 and that accident and emergency. The Chartered Society of Physiotherapy is campaigning that Scotland needs more physios, and that while undergraduate training places have doubled in England to meet demand, there has been no increase in Scotland in the last decade. This means that while Scottish course programmes are oversubscribed with applicants, not enough places are funded to meet the needs of Scotland's NHS. The shortage of physiotherapists impacts on our local communities, their services and staff. Physiotherapy is essentially reduced to hospital admissions, speed up discharge from hospital and reduce resilience on social care, which are all critical this winter. I am therefore asking you to urge the Scottish Government to urgently address the physiotherapy workforce shortages in Scotland. So I believe...
Member take an intervention?
Yep.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to Alex Riley for taking an intervention. And isn't it right that one of the roles that physiotherapy performs is allow people to return to work that much faster, stop trapping them in a period of sickness where they can't work? And actually, that is the perfect answer to what he is describing as the perfect storm that we find ourselves in now.
Alec Riley.
Yeah, I mean, I think Martin Whitfield is absolutely correct. And I think these are some of the key points that we hopefully will get across in this debate. So I believe my constituents set out very clearly the issues and challenges and how this situation impacting on the current workforce in physiotherapy. But in this chamber, and indeed across Scotland, people know the challenges and difficulties they're having in accessing GP services. And as the Chartered Society for Physiotherapy point out, Scotland's ageing society creates a growing population of frail elderly and those with multiple long-term conditions that require physiotherapy in acute and community settings. And I suggest we must look to how we can take some of the pressure from GP practices. And indeed, if you look at the Chartered Society website, there are case studies that demonstrate good practice. In NHS Forth Valley, a practice manager states, and I quote, "With new physiotherapists coming on board, there has been an increase in satisfaction as patients are being seen quicker. There appears to be fewer and more appropriate referrals going to secondary care, specifically orthopaedics. The physio practitioners encourage patients to self-manage, and patient safety is enhanced through early identification of serious pathology." And there are many good examples of good practice from across Scotland. A GP in Greenock is quoted as saying, "Of all the work that has ever been done in GP practices, this has been the one that feels like it has truly taken work away. Patients are safer, there is quicker access to the most appropriate intervention because triage assessment conducted by the physiotherapist get people to the right place sooner. So there is much evidence that demonstrates the effectiveness of this approach."
Paul Sweeney. Could we please have Mr Sweeney's microphone?
I thank my friend for giving way. He's making a very powerful speech. Indeed, as this country spends more on acute hospitals than any other developed country and the least on preventative community care, is he not showing that these examples are really powerful? And is it not frustrating to him, as it is to me, that the government seems seemingly incapable of capturing those examples of best practice and making it the national standard?
Alec Riley.
Absolutely, and that's the key point I hope we do get across today. So approaches, but as the Chartered Society of Physiotherapy state, effective workforce planning is essential and has been inadequate in Scotland. This has meant that while England has increased undergraduate physiotherapy training places by 96% since 2013, Scotland's undergraduate programme have seen virtually no increase in the last decade. That is why today I am making the call on the Scottish Government to plan the physiotherapy workforce, increase the number of training places for Scottish domiciled undergraduates, open new apprenticeships to qualifying and meet the demand for physiotherapists that are desperately needed across Scotland. We can, presiding officer, do so much better.
Thank you, Mr Riley. I now call Ruth Maguire to be followed by Sue Webber. Ms Maguire.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Physiotherapists play a really valuable role in improving the health and well-being of people across Scotland, and physiotherapy is essential in preventing hospital admissions, speeding up discharge, and supporting people to live independently. And these things, in turn, both improve the lives of individuals, but also help the healthcare system run efficiently and effectively. I congratulate Alec Rowley on securing cross-party support and bringing this debate on physiotherapy workforce shortage in Scotland to the chamber of our Scottish Parliament. I take very seriously the real-life experience of physiotherapists and the impact on their patients laid out in his speech. The Chartered Society of Physiotherapy's campaign, Scotland Needs More Physios, speaks to the need to supply to expand the supply of physiotherapists to the NHS in Scotland. Whilst acknowledging the very clear challenges laid out by Alec Rowley, and always mindful that for someone waiting for treatment, or indeed for practices or teams of staff under pressure unable to recruit, contexts are different, I do think it's helpful in this place to acknowledge the work that the Scottish Government is taking forward and some of the investment that's being made. The number of physiotherapists working in our NHS has increased by 29% over the last 10 years, and the Scottish Government has significantly expanded the primary care multidisciplinary team workforce. The support of these teams is done through an investment of £190 million in the Primary Care Improvement Fund. And so far, 144 students have been funded towards meeting the Scottish Government's target to create 225 more MSK practitioners to increase the physiotherapy workforce. I think it's probably important to also note that while training places may be higher in England, frontline health spending in Scotland per head remains and has consistently been more than in England, against what is undoubtedly a challenging economic and financial context. In terms of training and development for physiotherapists, I'm very interested in apprenticeships and other earn-as-you-learn pathways. I think in the context of shortages of the workforce, these open up career progression to those who are unable to attend university, be that through geography. We've certainly heard about that in the Health Committee's inquiry into rural healthcare, or indeed for older folk looking for a change of career. Maybe family commitments mean they can't attend university full time. At the beginning, Presiding Officer, I mentioned the context for those waiting for treatment, and I don't want to lose sight of that. There are also many who won't know about how treatment could assist them. Reflecting before this debate on the number of settings and treatments physiotherapists provide, I thought about women's health and chamber. Forgive me, hopefully this is not too much information. Physiotherapy for women's health can be life-changing and prevent really debilitating problems and conditions that can have a huge impact on well-being and quality of life. I first experienced physio after the birth of my first child, which was only 27 years ago, and it was actually just a 27. It was actually just a 10-minute chat where she explained physiology and told me about some exercise and gave me strict instructions to do them every time my hands were wet. And you wash your hands a lot when you have a newborn baby. So that knowledge I took forward 25 years later and used in my own recovery after cancer treatment. I believe it really helped stave off some of the potentially worst side effects of that treatment. Now, that side of things wasn't discussed in treatment discussions that I had with clinicians, and I actually think it should have been. Now, whether that was down to shortages of physiotherapists, or perhaps because teams treating folk with cancer are rightly laser focused on doing just that. But bearing in mind the challenges and shortages that have been highlighted, and understanding that where services are strained, priorities shift, I would be interested in hearing from the Minister what we can do to ensure that women's health is considered a priority, and particularly the importance of physiotherapy within that. Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms McGuire. I now call Sue Webber to be followed by Jackie Bailey. Ms Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I was really pleased to have a chance to speak in this debate today, as being a physiotherapist is a career that I once considered for myself, although life clearly took a different turn. I might go back to it later. You know, that's always an opportunity if we get things right. Amid record vacancy rates and a failure to increase undergraduate training places in Scotland, patients desperately need more physiotherapists. The Chartered Society of Physiotherapy said patients' recoveries are being put in jeopardy by worsening workforce crisis, with Scotland now lagging behind other parts of the UK on physiotherapy training. This shortage in Scotland's physiotherapy workforce creates further challenges across the healthcare system, and that ultimately impacts patient care. There are various factors contributing to the demand for physios, including an ageing population, an increase in chronic conditions, and a backlog of treatments that have been made worse by the pandemic. However, it's not just that there's an increased demand for physios, but the supply and the training of the physios has not kept pace with the demand. So addressing this shortage requires a real multifaceted approach. The Chartered Society of Physiotherapists have started a campaign, Scotland Needs More Physios, which is underscored by the belief that Scotland does not currently educate or train enough physiotherapists to supply the workforce needs and the population needs from that as well. Undergraduate training places have doubled in England to meet demand, but there has been no such increase in Scotland in the last decade, meaning that while Scottish course programmes are oversubscribed with applicants, not enough places are being funded to meet the needs of Scotland's NHS. Increasing the number of training places in physiotherapy programmes and enhancing support for students could and would help boost the number of new graduates entering the field. And furthermore, physiotherapists have stated that they are finding it extremely difficult to recruit staff for their practices across Scotland with record high vacancy rates. So this has a knock-on effect on existing staff morale as well, with increased levels of stress and work pressures, challenging working conditions, there's competitive salaries across schemes, and it's just an artificial pressure on the environment with people taking staff from one practice to another. And what you really need to do is have better working conditions, the best competitive salaries and opportunities for professional development to exist, to retain staff and attract new recruits. I recently met a physio who's made it clear just how important they are to people with arthritic joints, and I suppose I'd put myself in that bracket, as in someone with arthritic joints not being a physio. And it makes, right now, it's becoming much more prevalent among an ageing population and those that have been active and in a sporting life before coming into here. It's a real key profession in getting the terms of elderly patients who are stuck in hospital, and Mr Rowley said that in his opening remarks, more mobile and able to function themselves and get them home and much more independent. It would help in turn free up beds, appointments and doctors for other cases. A self-referral service would allow people to see a physio quickly, and to do that would also make it important for the patients to understand that it's as much down to them to be involved in their care. And Ruth Maguire's already said how important it was to do the exercises consistently that her physio had recommended, and that we have to be bought into the treatments that the physios give us. But it's not just the elderly, as I've said, who need this service. If you suffer from pain or an injury for a long time, you are likely to get injuries elsewhere as you compensate from your body, which can affect also your mental health. So physio and work physiotherapists do an essential part in our healthcare service, and they should never be underestimated or undervalued. So thank you very much, Mr Rowley, for bringing this important debate to the Chamber this afternoon.
Thank you, Ms Webber. And I now call Jackie Bailey.
Presiding Officer, let me join others in congratulating Alex Rowley for bringing this important debate to the Parliament and indeed for the content of his speech. He is absolutely right that this sits in the wider context of workforce planning and the inadequacy of the current position. Can I also thank the Chartered Society of Physiotherapy for their very informative briefing? There is no doubt in my mind about the value of physiotherapy, whether it's the positive impact on reducing hospital admissions, whether it's speeding up discharge from hospital, or whether it's about supporting those at home to live independent lives, moving away from a reliance on social care. Physiotherapy is worth its weight in gold. Like so much of the NHS, though, the physiotherapy service would be nothing without its staff, but there are simply not enough of them to meet demand. As Sue Webber herself said, vacancy rates are at a record high, averaging 11% across Scotland. And the consequence is longer waiting times and additional pressure on existing staff and existing services. So we need much better workforce planning. We need an increase in training places that meets that future demand. And whilst I am mindful of what was said earlier by Ruth Maguire, I do note that in NHS England, training places have increased by 42% in the last 10 years, a further 18% just in 21-22 alone. By contrast, Scotland's undergraduate physiotherapy programmes have shown virtually no increase since 2015, And that simply isn't good enough in the context of increasing demand. But there are steps that the Minister can take. Make physiotherapy a controlled subject for workforce planning in higher education. That will increase the number of places. As Alex Rowley himself said, establish a fund and learn routes, funding and learning routes, and consider things like apprenticeship models. Maintain the funded MSc physiotherapy bursary scheme and provide education and funding to support advanced practice. These measures taken together will go some way to alleviate the pressure, and I would urge the Minister to set out the concrete action she intends to take to address the matter. And the reason it's so important is that we will not fulfil our ambition to deliver more services in primary care without an expansion in those workforce numbers. Physiotherapists are being brought into GP surgeries to help patients with musculoskeletal conditions. Now, that's a good thing because it enhances patient care, it better integrates services, and at the same time, it reduces GP workloads. There is also less testing, less prescribing, and fewer secondary care referrals. It's better for the patient. There are also further opportunities in primary care. There will be patients with complex comorbidities, and physiotherapists with advanced practice skills can reduce, again, that reliance on GPs and inappropriate hospital admissions. And as Ruth Maguire eloquently said, there are opportunities in women's health, in pelvic, obstetrics and gynaecology that might avoid surgery. And of course, there is huge potential in community rehabilitation, reducing the number of people who become needlessly disabled and can contribute to them leading full and active lives. So it's good for patients and it reduces pressure on secondary care. We know that there is a beneficial impact for patients, for GPs, for secondary care to deliver more physiotherapy in primary care. But there are simply not enough physiotherapists. If the government agrees that this is the right direction of travel, we need to see the warm words matched by action. So let's see an increase in training places, and let's see it now. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Bailey. I now call on the Minister, Jenny Minto, to respond to the debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm grateful to Alex Rowley for securing this important debate. And I thank members for their excellent and also thoughtful and thought-provoking contributions. I very much appreciate it. It's clear that colleagues in this chamber value the critical role that physiotherapists play. They support our NHS and help improve the health and well-being of people across Scotland. And it's likely that everyone in this chamber has benefited from a physiotherapist's expertise at some point in their life. I know I certainly have. Every day, physiotherapists right across Scotland work with people of all ages and with a wide variety of health conditions, from acute neurological disorders and intensive care to management of long-term health conditions. Physiotherapists can help people achieve and maintain movement and function, which Alex Rowley and a number of others all commented upon. I know from my own portfolio that physiotherapists play an important role, as Ruth Maguire and Jackie Bailey have said, in improving women's health. And I think these Ms. Maguire's eloquent description of her own experience is incredibly helpful. And when preparing for this debate, it was an area that I specifically discussed and will follow up with my women's health team after the debate. As I've said, the physiotherapists work in a range of places, including hospitals, GP practices, people's homes, and in their workplaces. I was able to see the innovative nature of physiotherapists working alongside other AHPs, nurses, and bioengineers from Strathclyde University at University Hospital Wishaw, where their skills were put to good use in the rehabilitation of people living with strokes alongside new technology. And as Alex Rowley noted, rehabilitation is a key area of work for physiotherapists along with other members of the multidisciplinary team. This may involve helping people with a wide variety of problems through reducing their pain, improving their mobility and independence, and helping them back to a full life. However, prehabilitation, which ensures people to keep fit and ready for treatment, is also vital, with physiotherapists working alongside the leisure sector and third sector partners. And I've seen the value of this in my own constituency in Oban, And I think, as Paul Sweeney said, it is important to capture these good examples. And I was pleased to see Murray Leisure Centre, which Sue Webber touched on, the importance of people keeping up and taking on the exercises and the fitness prescribed by physiotherapists is happening within Elgin and perhaps actually in the facility of a leisure centre as opposed to a hospital, which again can have other benefits. Furthermore, as Martin Whitfield noted, physiotherapists are now able to legally certify and issue fit notes, and along with acting as the first contact for many people with musculoskeletal problems, helping to reduce the pressure on NHS doctors, particularly GPs. And when I attended the Scottish Health Awards last year, Jackie Bailey was also there, I was delighted to see that physiotherapist Polina Ranazuska win the Allied Health Professional category. The trophy was awarded in recognition of Polina's incredible compassion and expertise, which have brought hope and relief to many people living with long COVID. So I want to thank each and every one of our physiotherapists for the invaluable role that they play in our daily lives, as well as their positive impact in wider society. Both the motion and contributions from members today have raised concerns about a shortage of physiotherapists in Scotland, but I think it's important to note that there are currently over 3,500 people working in physiotherapy across NHS Scotland, which represents an increase of 29% over the last 10 years. This includes physiotherapy support workers, who are an integral part of the workforce and also play a vital role in achieving the best outcomes for individuals. At the end of December 2023, physiotherapy had a vacancy rate of 6.7%, which compares a year previous to 9.3%. And while it is positive that it's coming down, we also have to recognise that NHS Scotland is a large organisation, and given the natural turnover of staff in an organisation of this size, it will always carry some vacancies. The Scottish Government is not complacent, and I recognise the need to recruit and train greater numbers of physiotherapists for two reasons. Firstly, to support the workforce needs of the future and to ensure the sustainability of this vital profession. And secondly, if we're serious about reforming our NHS and delivering more preventative care, then physiotherapists will be a key component of this, as Alec Rowley quoted from his constituent. Our determination to address workforce challenges and increase the number of physiotherapists is not just warm words. It can be demonstrated by our actions. In December 2019, the Integrated Health and Social Care Workforce Plan for Scotland made a commitment to create an additional 225 advanced musculoskeletal practitioners in primary care by increasing training places for the physiotherapy workforce. The Physiotherapy Funded Places Scheme has provided funding of tuition fees for selected postgraduate pre-registration students to increase the number of home students to support this. Delays were experienced due to the pandemic. However, to date, 144 physiotherapy students have been recruited, and the first cohort of students graduated in September 2023. This is down to government policy ambitions to increase the number of the workforce numbers, and was designed collaboratively with both the higher education institutions and health boards to ensure its implementation benefited every part of Scotland, particularly rural and island areas. The Scottish Government has also concluded an Allied Health Profession Education and Workforce Review at the start of 2023. Leaders across AHP professions, including physiotherapy, work collaboratively to examine workforce and education issues to improve our understanding and alignment between the two. The review made a number of recommendations, including widening access through earn-as-you-learn models, which have been noted by contributions, and the promotion of AHP careers. The AHP review also recognised the importance of improving our data so that we design a workforce which is fit for the future and reflects the needs of our population. Our physiotherapy student intake numbers have generally remained consistent throughout the last 4 years, but by building greater capacity within our workforce to support practice placements, this will provide an opportunity for our higher education establishments to increase our current student intake numbers. An advisory board is overseeing the effective implementation of these recommendations to ensure we develop an AHP workforce to meet the current and future needs of Scotland's health and care system. So I am really pleased that we are engaging with the Chartered Society of Physiotherapy in Scotland, and I hope that that continues. I'm sure it will. Presiding Officer, I'd like to close today's debate by thanking all of those who've participated and shared their views about this inspiring profession. And thank you again to Alec Rowley for bringing forward the motion. I would be very happy to discuss any of the points raised today with members, particularly where it relates to public health and women's health, should that be helpful. I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary would also be open to this. I hope we've demonstrated today that physiotherapists are integral to delivering the health and care services we need and regard to which this government holds them in. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I suspend this meeting until 2 p.m. Thank you.